Evening, everybody. We are on the third Friday of June, month dedicated to the most holy, sacred heart of Jesus. So let us begin our session with the sign of the cross. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. O loving Father, you have expressed to us your love by sending us your only divine Son, the incarnate Word of God, Jesus of Nazareth, Son of Mary, with his foster father Joseph. May this third session of wanting, not only to understand, but above all to appreciate your love and live it, and even share it and show it to those in need of that love, to be assured that your love is without bounds, that your love is for all. May we ask your Spirit to be with us in mind and in heart particularly, so that what we can understand, our hearts may be committed not only to imitate, but above all, to give that life of love to those in need of such goodness. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Most Sacred Heart of Jesus, have mercy on us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Once more, good evening po. I hope everybody already have come to the first and second, and this being the third of a four episode or four Fridays of June, taking into consideration the 12 promises. And so, having done with six promises of the Sacred Heart, one particularly that looks into the state of life and especially into the life of a family, I've shared my experience from my own family. And the second week or the second Friday, by having the sharing of another person, one of my staff members here at the Don Bosco School of Theology, how in her own family as well, she experienced the love of the Sacred Heart, starting with her own father and mother, how that grace helped her parents be faithful to each other, and how she has accepted the death of her husband, and though in deep affliction, she has rested her heart in the heart of Jesus. And so she comes out, though probably we could say, in a battle, she was kind of sometimes bruised and broken, but in the end, with the promise of the heart of Jesus, she found herself to be a battle-tested woman. And because of all those experiences, she has become we could say a stronger person. And so the promises of the heart of Jesus to an individual happened to this lady that I have introduced to you as Miss Maybelline Josefa Santos Ferreros. So now let's go to the third, and we could look into the the PowerPoint that I have prepared for tonight, and here now I share with you. So we continue with the cover page of the 12 promises of the heart of Jesus, and saying that we are using the encyclical letter of Pope Pius XII of 1956, Haurietes Aquas, which is a Latin text of that Isaiah 12, chapter 12, verse 3, that says, you will draw waters. Haurietes Aquas, draw waters from the spring of salvation. However, we said that this Haurietes Aquas actually a prediction of Isaiah chapter 12, even in chapter 55, from his heart shall flow streams of living water. We find it manifested, and we could say lived, in the heart of the only begotten Son of God, the Father. So it was Jesus in John chapter 7, verse 38, that says, let anyone who believes in me come and drink. And this exactly happened when blood and water came from his pierced side. Since he was speaking of the Spirit then that has not yet been received, it was on the day of his death on the cross, dead already, but the Spirit was given out with the elements of his dead body, life-giving blood, life-giving water. This is the Spirit. Now, if we would continue reflecting on and basing our reflection on the next three promises of the Sacred Heart, it was Pope Pius XII that tells us that this divine charity is a most precious gift of the heart of Jesus and of the Spirit. Divine charity. Now, this divine charity was first imparted to the apostles. So these were the persons that were with Jesus. And many of them became martyrs. But they really fought their battles like heroes to death, so that in preaching the truth of the gospel, in bearing witness to it, they were willing to shed their blood, just like Jesus, their master. Now, this divine charity, Pope Pius XII said, he also implanted it beyond the first generation of Christians, beyond the apostolic times. And he implanted it in the doctors of the church, in the early forefathers of our faith. And he gave it to confessors, to men and women, by their holiness. He roused them to those marvelous works useful for their salvation and for the salvation of others, not just in this life, but for the next. Finally, this was given to virgins to a free and joyful withdrawal from the pleasures of the senses, to a complete dedication of themselves to the love of their heavenly spouse. You can see how through time, the Holy Father, Pope Pius XII, gives a presentation of a summary how the charity, the love of the heart of Jesus, was manifested by the apostles to the point of martyrdom, shared now to the doctors of the church. We call them the fathers in tradition, and later on, saints, confessors who professed their faith, and now even to that joyful virginity that showed a complete dedication of oneself to the love of the spouse that is Jesus. It is exactly in this virginal love for Jesus that we find persons who have experienced the promise fulfilled from the heart of the Savior. Thomas Aquinas tells us that from the side of Christ, the water was a cleansing water, and the blood was a redeeming blood. So therefore, he says, this blood is now associated with the Eucharist, while the water is now associated with the sacrament of baptism, cleansing and redeeming. So the two elements that burst forth from the side of Jesus on the day he died is the birth of the church that offers us through her sacraments of baptism and the Eucharist, not only cleansing from our sins, but redemption and forgiveness. This kind of reflection of St. Thomas in the 13th century of Christianity became very much alive something like 4 centuries after, particularly with this saint's John Eudes, 1601 to 1680, and a much younger, 40 years younger, and yet he lived only 2 years after the death of Eudes, St. Claude de la Colombier. And you could see that this man is almost very much contemporary, older by just about 6 years, to the person whom Jesus showed, manifested, and revealed the promises of his Sacred Heart, St. Margaret Mary Alacoque, 1647-1690. As you could see that they are contemporaries, John Eudes lived for 79 years, although Colombier was only for 41 years, and Margaret Mary, 43 years. So the two were young. Now, why am I sharing with you? Because John Eudes, he is also the founder of the Religious of the Good Shepherd, RGS we call them, no? He spoke already of the heart of the Redeemer, the merciful, loving, shepherd heart of the Redeemer. You could see the heart in his left hand and the crucifix on his right. Who are they? They were the ones who started to bring about a liturgical, not a doctrinal, a teaching, but a celebration of this divine charity to humanity and the appreciation of this redeeming, cleansing love of Jesus found in his heart. So it was St. John Eudes that promoted the reflection on the heart of Jesus. And he said there was only one heart, the heart of Jesus and the heart of Mary. The heart of God and the heart of the human person combined in the heart of one person called Jesus. And this was further reflected and revealed to St. Margaret Mary Alacoque. And so it was St. John Eudes who was responsible for making a liturgical office. That means he made prayers to celebrate the Feast of the Sacred Heart. And this became widespread in France thanks to the acceptance of their bishops. And so October 20, 1672 was the first time they put up a liturgical feast, a celebration of God's people on the Sacred Heart. So no longer just a private devotion, a private prayer, but a universal in the sense that it has been opened to the public, a devotion to the heart of Jesus. And therefore, given this, in that sense of an earlier reflection of John Eudes, St. Claude de la Colombier and Mary Margaret Alacoque, on par with an unusual zeal to see to it that the real meaning of the devotion that had extensive developments in their country, France, to the great edification of the faithful should be established and be distinguished, so we have this revelation of how the heart of Jesus seeks a reciprocal love and reparation for sins. So because of this, we have now these three promises, now 7, 8, 9, fervent souls shall quickly mount to high perfection. So people who are really devoted to God, because of the devotion to the heart of Jesus, will quickly grow in greater charity, in what we would call the perfection of love. But even lukewarm souls, those who do not have a devotion, probably we could say, at that time maybe we could say, churchgoers, although those are the majority in Europe at that time, the promise is there will also be a change. If fervent will become, arrive at a certain high perfection, lukewarm shall become fervent. Look at the third. But sinners will find in my heart the source and infinite ocean of mercy. I group these promises together because you can see that the promise of the love of the divine charity of the heart of Jesus is not only for the sinner. That's the lowest, or just for a mediocre Christianity, but even for those who already are very much caught up, dedicated to loving God with all of his heart or soul. So there is growth, we could say. There's growth in the fervent souls, in the lukewarm souls, and there is a return of the sinner. Let's go first to the first promise, no? Fervent souls shall quickly mount to the height of perfection. And here is a Frenchman, 1797, 1863. Quite, we could say, older, but contemporary to our saintly founder of my congregation, St. John Bosco. So he's already born in the 19th century and experienced somehow the aftermath, 1789, of the French Revolution. And so he saw his family, you know, taking care of priests during the persecution in France of the clergy. And so this person put up his own religious congregation, and for the first time, he dedicated this congregation to the heart of Jesus. And their purpose is to evangelize by going out into the missions and also in the growth or education of young people. John Paul II, no, in meeting the priests of this founder, said, "Today, by living the spirituality of the heart of Jesus, consumed by love of us, your priests, the priests of your institute, are following an admirable school for their personal life, for their missions. They will let themselves to be led by the Spirit in order to serve the church according to the heart of God, by giving themselves totally through love for their brothers and sisters' salvation." So already they are priests, already they are fervent, but they will even grow more if, when they put their devotion or make a spirituality of the heart of Jesus that could consume their love for, zeal for souls in the missions, making their hearts really aflame with love for those who are seeking salvation. Another person is someone we know better, because in Santa Cruz, Manila, not in the province of Laguna, we have a church called the Blessed Sacrament, no? The Church of the Blessed Sacrament Fathers in Santa Cruz. And their founder of the Blessed Sacrament Fathers, SSS, ang ibig sabihin nun is the Society of the Most Holy Sacrament, no? Sacratissimum, what is it? Anyway, it's Latin, no? Societas, Society of the Most Holy Sacrament, Eucharist. No? So St. Peter Julian Aimard, another French person, remember how this devotion grew and got really known and spread out first in the country of St. Margaret Mary Alacoque. He sought above all things to promote a devotion to the Eucharist. Sacratissimum Sacramentum, yeah, that's the one. But he connected this love for the body of Christ with a devotion to the heart of that body, a love for the Sacred Heart. He was the one who wrote Reflections on the Heart, explaining that devotion to the heart of Jesus has a twofold objective. It honors with adoration and public worship the heart of the flesh of Jesus, and the infinite love with which his heart has burned for us since its creation, and with which it is still consumed in the sacrament of the altar. So he was the one that explicitly said that living out a Eucharistic devotion, because you love the body of Christ in the Eucharist, you would also foster or grow in the love of the heart of Jesus. So receiving, adoring, worshiping the Eucharist, you would obtain somehow that fervor to love better with the heart, no? Influenced by the heart of the most sacred heart of Jesus. So fervent souls who take the Eucharist seriously and even more regularly than others, like even every day, because of that Eucharistic devotion, they show that devotion in their love for others because of the heart of Jesus. Here is a modern saint. He will be canonized soon. Could you just imagine Blessed Carlo Acutis of Argentina, 1981. I was born 1953. 81. About 43 years ago. No? And then he died 2006. So how old was this boy, this young man? No? So 2001, he became 20 years old. He was 25, correct? So what happened? Carlo Acutis became a light that drew others into the love of the heart of Jesus. Why? Because he usually sought Jesus in silence, in mystery, in beauty, and in poverty. Because of that, he was always found before Jesus in the Eucharist. You know, what we would call this millennial. If he were alive, he would just be in his middle 40s, 43 years old, if he were alive today. And because of his devotion to the heart of Jesus, he started to draw others to the love of the heart of Jesus. He says, we have all been created with the potential to be saints, but God made us free, free to do good, but also evil. So he said, I want to follow the example of John the Apostle, the beloved disciple, where each one of us can become the beloved of Jesus as John was. What does it mean, he said, to be a disciple of Jesus like John, a beloved? He said, Jesus drew his friendship with John through three gifts of love. First, physically letting the head of Jesus rest near his Sacred Heart at the Last Supper. They say in that moment, there was a very deep spiritual experience of this disciple whom Jesus loved, when Jesus allowed him to lean on his breast on the Last Supper. And that breast means to lean on his Sacred Heart. So he said, this is the first gift, to become like this beloved disciple and have this deep intimacy with Jesus by laying my head near his heart. The second gift, of course, was the gift of the Blessed Mother, and above all, to make John's love perfect, Jesus gave him a share in his cross during his lifetime. So Carlo Acutis saw, what is that? The resting of the head of John, the beloved disciple, near the heart of Jesus, as the image of what every Christian life should be. That is, every Christian is more than just going to church, is developing a heart-to-heart relationship with Jesus in the Eucharist, rooted in his friendship. So this young man, dying, what 25 years old, such a young man, and yet he was able to rise to the heights of perfection. So the promise of the Sacred Heart, we pray, Heart of Jesus, fountain of life and holiness, have mercy on us. So I'd like to share with you that the promise is true with that saint that promoted the heart of Jesus, Saint John Hughes, Saint Claude de Colombier, with Saint Margaret Mary Alacoque. It was to her that Jesus revealed about his heart. And later, even beyond the liturgy that were able to make happen, fervent souls grew to perfection because drawing from the heart of Jesus, they became an expression of his divine charity. And the most recent is Carlo Acutis. The second promise that we would say today, I just like to refer us to the encyclical Haurietis Aquas. Why? Because I would not want to look for lukewarm souls that became fervent. Maybe that's too personal and maybe even too much judgmental on my part. So I would rather put it from the document or from the encyclical letter, and here the numbers speak where you can find them. Fervent devotional practice towards the heart of Jesus will beyond all doubt foster and advance, diba? Remember, advance devotion to the Holy Cross and the love of the most holy sacrament of the altar. So lukewarm souls, if they enter into a devotional practice, will advance as well, shall become fervent. The next paragraph, moved by an earnest desire to set strong bulwarks against the wicked designs of those who hate God and the church, at the same time to lead men back in their private public life to a love of God and their neighbor, we do not hesitate to declare that the devotion to the heart is a very effective school of the love of God. So what will make lukewarm souls fervent? When they learn and practice the divine charity, the love of God that becomes for them the affective school. When a lukewarm soul, by her devotion to the heart of Jesus, is pushed to greater heights, whether lukewarm or fervent, there is a growth. Pope Francis today, in an audience during this month of June 2024, said that last 27th of December 2023 marked the 350th anniversary of the first of Margaret Mary Alacoque's visions of the heart of Jesus. So look at him now. that old man on a wheelchair that cannot walk properly anymore, and how he loves to have this selfie. But he says he recalled on the 27th of December, so this is being this month in June, but he recalls that we have celebrated the first apparition. But you know that the apparitions of Jesus to Saint Margaret Mary Alacoque lasted for 2 years, until 1675. So he said, no, that devotion that began in many countries and across the world, we will conclude with June 27 next year, 2025, because it also covers the 350th anniversary of this great manifestation, a kind of telling us what is at the heart of God by showing us the heart of Jesus. So he said, by September of this year, I will write a document that gathers precious reflections of teachings of the church, long dating back to the Holy Scriptures. That's what we have done. That's what we did. First session was on the Word of God. The second session was on the fathers of the church. And now also we're talking about saints, doctors like Francis de Sales or John Hughes. No? So he says, to reintroduce today to the whole church the devotion, this devotion full of spiritual beauty. Sabi niya, I believe it will be very beneficial for us to meditate. He's preparing this letter on various aspects of the Lord's love so that that love can illuminate the path of renewal, pagbabago. So lukewarm souls will become fervent. So he says, I'd like to say something significant to a world that seems to have lost its heart. Yun ang kanyang concern actually. While he will take advantage of the 350th anniversary from 2023 up to 2025, it is because he feels the heart of Jesus can be offered as a remedy to the world today who seems to have lost its own heart. Walang zeal, walang focus, intentionality, yan sabi niya. So let's pray, Heart of Jesus, enriching all those who invoke thee, have mercy on us. So finally, we go to sinners. If we go again to this encyclical letter, Haurietes Aquas, Pope Pius XII said, hatred of God. Now we're talking about the sinner. And of those who lawfully act in his place, who think they are gods, is the greatest kind of sin that can be committed by man created in the image and likeness of God. While we are his image and likeness and destined to enjoy his perfect enduring friendship, yet the difficulty that we face is that many people harbor a hatred for God and do not anymore appreciate the depth or the meaning of being human. So this is fostered by materialism, false slogans, which are spread out by act and argument, unbridled license of unlawful desires. Is it remarkable that love loses its warmth in the souls of many? When so many evils meet our gaze, such as cause sharp conflict among individuals, families, and nations, the world, and who says, where are we to seek a remedy? Venerable brethren, if not at the ocean of mercy. I'd like therefore to present to you a very important person in a modern character of our faith. She died in 1956, Kaba. And we're talking about Saint Maria Goretti. Now, this man, Alessandro Serenelli, who was senior to Maria Goretti, she was only 12, and this man was being 20 to 21 years old, tried to rape Maria Goretti. They belonged to a common house, though different families, and this young man at the age of 21 lusted, now looked at the materiality and did not think about the dignity of the person. And so he wrote in a diary, this man called Alessandro Serenelli left a diary, and one entry says, I can see that in my early youth, I chose a bad path, which led me to ruin myself. My behavior was influenced by print, mass media, bad examples, which are followed by the majority of young people without even thinking. So I did the same, and I was not worried. While there were many generous, devoted people around him, he never paid attention to them, because a violent force blinded me, pushed me toward a wrong way of life. So this is his manifestation, or his witnessing. Now, this particular person accosted a young girl that lived in the same apartment. And this is the 12-year-old Saint Maria Goretti. And when she was dying, because there was the attempt to rape her by this Alessandro Serenelli, that young man with that face, it did not happen. And because of this, he stabbed her. He stabbed Maria Goretti 13 times. And then thought that she was already dead. But when he came back, he saw that Maria Goretti was moving towards the steps of the house. They were in the second floor, and maybe would be able to free herself. So, but one more, thrust of the knife, she succumbed to death. Now, in that time, she did succumb, of time. And the parish priest asked Maria Goretti, would you forgive your assailant? For the love of Jesus, yes, I forgive him. And I even want him to be with me in heaven. So I don't know if you have heard and known the story of Maria Goretti. I'm sure you did. But how about the story of the man who tried to rape her? Alessandro Serenelli. This is an Italian text that was found in his diary. Now, he died a street sweeper, a house cleaner among the Franciscan Capuchins in Italy. And this, one of the entries of his journal is, Chiedo perdona al mondo. I ask pardon from the world per l'oltraggio fatto alla martire Maria Goretti, alla purezza. No? So he said, I ask pardon to the world for what I have done to Maria Goretti, to the martyr Maria Goretti, against purity. Therefore, he says, esorto tutti, I exhort everyone, di tenersi lontani dagli spettacoli immorali. Here we're talking about the late 60s. To please go away, free yourself. No? Even if they are treasures, but try, no? Try to leave everything, especially immoral shows. These are very dangerous. These are dangerous occasions that can put one to do and commit a sin. Che possono portare al peccato. Do you know that this man, Alessandro Sarinelli, he went to prison that was because he was caught by the police. He went into prison and he was bitter. He did not accept that he attempted to rape a Maria Goretti. And for the 7 years he was in prison, on the 8th year he had a vision. In a dream, Maria Goretti came and told him that she has forgiven him. This shifted his life. This made him really repentant. And with that sorrow for one sin, accepting, she accepted that he was truly a murderer and an attempt towards raping Maria Goretti. He said the source of this is social media. We're talking about the 60s. Spettacoli immorali, shows that are immoral, because they can bring us to sin. So look at this, sinners can find in my heart the source, an infinite ocean of mercy. Can a form of devotion surpassing that of the most sacred heart of Jesus be found which corresponds better to the character of the Catholic faith, more capable of assisting the present needs of the church and humanity? You know what happened now to that Alessandro Sarinelli? When he saw Maria Goretti in a dream, in a vision, he said, he heard her say, "Alessandro, I have forgiven you." And that instance, a kind of conversion seared into his heart, a flame that burnt and cleansed his soul. And for the next 19 years, he was in prison for 27 years, because in the 19 years that followed, he became a very good man. Sinners will find in my heart the source and infinite ocean of mercy. He therefore was supposed to have a life term in prison, but he was able to show in the 27 years his growth in love. He didn't even want to go away from prison, but he was sent away from prison. I think after 27 years, Alessandro. And he ended up as a Capuchin monk. In Italy, he knocked at the door of a Franciscan monastery and he was admitted as a sweeper, a street sweeper of the internal facilities of these Franciscans. He became a kind of all-around person, gardener and even guard, now watchman. Now you imagine that he was able to be present during the canonization of Saint Maria Goretti, as well as now his life, his story has been known. He is even on the way to beatification and canonization. Well, just imagine, sinners will turn around because of the infinite ocean of the heart of Jesus. I'd like to conclude saying, with Pope Francis having put this model, in the history of the church, there's something that is not as dramatic as what happened to Francis of Assisi. He was a very worldly person. Daming barkada. And yet, because of that barkada, they went, no, to go to the Holy Land to become chivalrous. No? Yung yabang eh. They went to the Holy Land to conquer the Holy Land from the Muslims. But then they got defeated. And that's where he had a conversion. And that conversion was to give his clothes to a leper. He was inspired of something otherworldly, not of this world. And this turned around the life of Francis of Assisi, renouncing even his father's clothing business and to reparation for sins. He became a hermit at the end of his life and was found when he died bearing the five wounds of the Savior Jesus Christ. Two hands, 2 feet, and at the side. I think this is the most dramatic personage in the Christian history that shows us that the heart of Jesus is really an ocean of love. And so for those who, you know, who pray and try to imitate the heart, you know, of Jesus, really changes will happen to his life. From fervent to perfection, from lukewarmness to fervent, and even from a sinner to change one's mind. A spiritual reparation. That's how I end my sharing. Would you like now to address some questions? We've got something like 15 minutes or 12 minutes. So I shared with you the growth in holiness, fervent to perfection, lukewarm to fervent, and of course, sinners to have a change of heart. That somehow says that the promises of the Sacred Heart are really true. So if in the first meeting I shared with you the scriptures, and in the second meeting I shared with you, the tradition of the fathers, now I'm sharing with you the saints, the modern saints, so modern that even he is our contemporary, Blessed Carlo Acutis. So, any question, po? There's a chat box. Oh, there are already. The three promises, sabi ni Jerome, is very much like the Divine Mercy. Oh, yes. That will be next week. Next week, we'll make the connection between the heart of Jesus and the Divine Mercy. Ah, yes, we will also share about the difference of the two. That is in store. I have already finished the reflection on the fourth and the last three promises of the heart of Jesus. Thank you, Jerome. Anyone else, Paul? Yes, from Hamburg. Ah, yes, Sister Faustina Kowalska was a devotee of the heart of Jesus, but she received also that apparition. It's interesting, and we will discuss it next week. Were there apparitions of Jesus after his ascension? The answer is yes, there were many. But the more famous is the one of Margaret Mary Alacoque of France and of this sister, Faustina, Maria Faustina Kowalska. We'll talk about it next week. Thank you, Ren Regina. Thank you, Sister Jilin. Any hand that you'd like to raise tonight? Malinaw po ba? I tried to group them into a kind of thematic, and our theme tonight is one more of a, if the first night was all about family and my experience of family, and the second night is how the devotion to the heart of Jesus fosters, no? Fosters a sense of trust in the moments of affliction. Today it's trying to see growth in divine charity. Even those who are already very fervent will still change for the better. What more the lukewarm and above all the sinner. So we have interesting about learning tonight. And thank you then, Cherry. If I'm not mistaken, St. John Hughes promoted the twin hearts of Jesus and Mary. Yes, because St. Francis de Sales spoke more about the heart of Jesus and Mary. And John Hughes also spoke of that, but then later said the hearts of Jesus and Mary. Now, we have discussed about the twin hearts in the Alliance of the Twin Hearts conference way back, I think 25 years ago, more maybe, no? I remember I was in that Congress, National Congress of the Twin Hearts, of the Alliance of the Two Hearts. The two hearts of human, Mary's, and the heart of God, which is divine, and Jesus's. No? They beat as one when that Son of God became incarnate in the womb of the Blessed Virgin. For definitely 9 months, the heart of man and the heart of God was just one beat. You know, physically, of course, but I believe even spiritually. So that's in the one of Mary. So yes, twin hearts. But we don't anymore now talk about twins, but we talk about two hearts. Yes. Ah, Regina backsliding. Well, everybody commits sin. When you say about backsliding, that you return to your old ways. That's very, very possible. If not for the grace of God, St. Augustine said, I too would be in that house of ill reputation, not a house of. So when we talk about, but you're saying here that backsliding. We definitely get the grace of God, but we could also be losing it. That's what you mean by backsliding. How is the heart of Jesus here? What the promise is? It's there. No? Sinners, lukewarm, they will experience the love of the heart of Jesus. It will make them change, because somehow change is not permanent. Maybe change is the only permanent thing, but the definitive change towards God could wane. So the heart of Jesus looks even for them. Yung lady, yung tungkol sa family and love, actually we discussed it. No, it was the first group of the promises of the heart of Jesus that we discussed in June. I think June, if now is June 7, then June 14, 21, and next week, 28. Yes, we have discussed that. Sabi niya, I can make hearts chaste also. Chastity is not virginity. No? Virginity has something to do also with the physical aspect. But chastity can be a decision. Can be a personal decision that even if one has committed sin before, and yet can get that change of heart. That's why we're talking about the lukewarm, the fervent, and the sinner. So we have dealt with that in the first two. I exemplified my family, no, lady. Now, Chloe Flores. Thank you for your thank you. Can make hearts chaste? Yes, of course. Yes, of course. And chastity is also to become single-hearted. That one's love is only possible if it is God's love. Yeah. What about Alessandro? Alessandro had a real change of heart thanks to that dream. And he got committed to that and tried to live it out in a context of men, Capuchins, that are living out the tenets of the love of God. Consecration. Nagustuhan mo yung storya ni Alessandro, Chloe. Fathers, pwede po ba sa final Zoom meeting? We could pray the consecration. Okay, let's pray that consecration to the heart of Jesus. Thank you for that. And I touched about the twin hearts. Okay, we can have that discussion. And the heart of Jesus and the Immaculate Heart of Mary. Okay, so there we are. It's now about 8:29. So we pray. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. And may the Almighty Father, together with his Son, bless us all, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Good night. God bless you. See you.